Dance, turn this shit into a nightclub. Hey. We're back. Hey, Bree.
Hey, Jay.
You miss me?
A little bit. I miss my voice, too.
Where did it go?
I don't know. Ja Rule took it over for a while.
I ain't gonna lie. You did sound like a whole dude when you called me the day. I can't record.
You know, it's still sorry, there. This is like a 3 week.
Sound thing. Like a Jesus. Is this Bree?
He probably thought somebody was prank calling on my phone.
What? I can't record.
Yeah, so he's like, no, I didn't hear nothing you
I
said.
Hear nothing you said. But yeah, so how long has it been? Like 2 weeks?
Yeah, probably well over.
Since I laid eyes on that beautiful face.
Yes, maybe.
You're welcome.
Thanks. I didn't know if a song was gonna come up with that because you know you tend to do the lyric thing.
My bad. You're welcome though.
Oh, thanks.
You are very, very welcome. How have you been other than sick and voiceless? Ursula got your voice. That's who got
that's
it.
What I said. I said that. Oh my God. See, look, we really are destined to be. I've been saying Ursula coming around stealing people's voices, and mine was one of them. Yeah, like all of that. It was probably bad at the Bad Bunny concert because I went
the
to
bad
that.
What?
Bad Bunny. You know, Bad Bunny?
Oh.
Okay, he's on, you know, Cardi B's
song.
Why
I know who he is, but why did you say Bunny?
Because that's how you say it when you're, like, in a Hispanic community.
When you're Puerto Rican?
You say Bad Bunny.
When you're in something that ends in a
bad.
Tan.
There's also man, Guatemalan. You know, Guatemalan.
It's an, so.
American.
So you say it. Oh, there you go.
I say
look.
Bad Bunny. Okay?
Ooh, I like that.
I thought Bad
yes,
Bunny was a woman.
Me.
A lot of cans.
Yes, thank you.
I thought
my
Bad
mom
Bunny
tells
was
me
a
all
woman.
The time. Well, she tells my son, really, you're a Puerto Rican, not a Puerto Rican. So I don't want to hear you. I can't do anything. There you
I
go.
I thought that was a Mexican or Mexican.
You know what? I just want to throw a water bottle at you.
I don't know. Just gotta give my people their props.
Anyway,
they about to get blocked out by the
listen,
wall.
Listen, I had like started to lose my voice the day before the concert,
right.
And it was starting to get raspy. But like it was like a cute raspy. I'm not even gonna lie, it was like a whole nother persona that I took on.
I was gonna make a reference until you said cute raspy, and then it wouldn't have made sense. I'd be like, well, like Jada Kissing, like yeah, he has a cute raspy. No, I'm not saying cute kisses, cute and raspy.
God.
I was really about soon.
No,
she, I was about
I
to
was
say, sing, yeah,
let me
said,
tell you,
raspy.
I was like
yeah.
singing Fantasia Barrino for a minute just because my voice could do it.
In a black community, we call her Fantasia. We don't say the last name. Sorry.
I didn't even know that was her last name.
Well,
see,
I thought it was just Fantasia.
All right, but like, let me know what I know
like
and
Monica,
say what I
like,
say.
Yeah, I don't. Yeah.
The only Monica I know is Lewinsky.
New Monica.
So gone.
Oh my God. So I'm sorry, go ahead.
Anyway, I started to lose it. Then like I couldn't back out by the time I got the tickets. They were like months in advance for my brother's birthday. So I'm here in the stands. There's a crowd full of people trying to sing and rap songs like this. There's like no whistle.
You heard you.
I heard me. And that's all that mattered.
Okay.
You're right.
Well, we're back. And this is not Safe for Work podcast because it's not safe most of the time. Majority of the time. 99.9%
we're pretty much as effective or not at the percentage of a condom. There's still a chance of it not being safe.
Yeah. Okay.
No?
No, you're right.
Oh, okay.
But this is that 1% or that one...
It's 0.1.
0.1% that we're not going to be not safe for work. We're going to be safe for work because we have a guest on our show today. I don't have sound effects. Cool shit. Like the podcast brothers and all of them. Shout out to them on their 100 show. We have my man, Brad Butler. Do I got to say the second or no?
Okay.
Brad Butler, the second in the building.
Numero dos.
No, what she
that's
said.
The first. That's the first.
You scoot closer, my brother.
That is the first.
So, we're just here. Not Safe for Work podcast. We'll be. To break it down, like, because you was on the Podcast Brothers before.
Yes, I was.
And then that's what Flaw hit us up and was just like, yo, we have a good brother who's looking to just, you know, get his podcast touring on.
Mm-hmm.
I like that. I like that phrase, touring.
Podcast touring.
Yeah, hey, listen, that could be something new. Let's start a podcast, radio tour. Just
all tours, just everything.
All over.
Spread they word.
So
yes,
we
podcast centrists.
Yeah, so I said, nah, bring him on because we like to... We like each other, but then we like to bring other people into our madness. So we're going to bring you into our madness, but then we're going to keep it the clean madness, and then we're going to get into what you're here for. How was your week today, my brother? Or how was your week? Not today, but how was your week?
My week was fine. Like, I can't think of anything that was, you know, too hectic or crazy about it. I mean, I'm always busy. I'm always constantly, you know, working, doing something, trying to get things done. So I'm tired a lot, but, you know, I wouldn't have it any other way. So.
My man. Nah, I had a, not a crazy week, but I just moved back home to mama's, left the suburbs, come back to the hood. Second night, crazy ass shooting behind the house. Like, goddamn. Welcome back, brother.
For real. That was a welcome home party. You just didn't know.
Facts. So, nah, that's it, though. Work. My car was down for 2 weeks. I finally got my baby back. I got the Honda Wraith back. Yeah.
That's rough. I know how that feels.
Got the Honda Wraith back. But other than that, my brother, I've been cool. And my sister.
I don't know. Like, do I bow to that?
We're not a Haitian.
I'm usually used to the insults. So, you know, this is a little unorthodox.
Oh, because I'm chilling. I'm clean today.
No, lately you've just been real, like, on your calm stuff. And I don't know if I like it. Like, I like it that you're getting your stuff together. Okay. But at the same time, I'm just used to an insult here, too, you know? Is that okay?
Yes, that is perfect. Okay. That is perfect.
All right.
That is perfect.
You two are like brother and sister.
Yeah. Sometimes it's like Jay at one point was like my work boo.
Okay.
If that makes sense. Because I would tell him, you have to do whatever I say and get me food.
Oh, okay.
Yes.
It wasn't one-sided, though. You would say the same thing. Take my money and go get the food.
Yes. Or I'll come into work and she love me. Look, I just got here.
So?
You don't look happy. You can't love me today.
Oh, wow. All right. That's one way to start the day.
Yeah, right. Thank you. But nah, we're cool. We gel the way we gel. Mm-hmm. And we're not safe at work. So let's talk about what's going on in the world. Nike.
Okay.
I mean, I'm actually just... I understand that there's a sense of ulterior motive behind it. Mm-hmm. Like, you know what I mean? It's not just because of a good cause. Like, not a brand like that, I'm sorry, where they profit off of, you know, all these sports teams and any of the athletes. So, in my opinion, I'm glad that they were the one to use a platform to say something. But I also feel like it was too late.
I don't know. I'll say that I feel like it's never too late to do something positive. I don't think it's ever too late to do something that could potentially affect millions of people. So, better late than never.
I want to know what this one over here thinks too, cuz like, look at him holding his tongue.
This is my whole thing. And I put this in a group when we was talking about it. I'm all for what they're doing. I'm all for the support. I'm all for that. But my whole thing is, like, keep the same energy now. You get what I'm saying? Just because you signed someone who has a movement or who's doing something, I mean, like, not to say positive, but, like, of course it's positive, but who's, you know what I mean, who's heading a movement, who sacrificed his paycheck to... No, change what's how we're treated amongst the world. I haven't seen, correct me if I'm wrong. Like, somebody comment, do whatever they gotta do. Correct me if I'm wrong, but I have yet to see Nike speak out about the police brutality.
Right.
The injustice. Excuse my language. F the kneeling. Because I have different views on that too. Mm. You get what I'm saying? But y'all have yet to speak on it, but they're signing them and gave them a bigger platform. Yeah, but I can not like you, but I can see value in you that you're going to make my pockets fat. And I, all right, whatever. Huh, let me give you this little bit of change on top of the money that you'll get back. So my thought process of it, my views of it was, you see the way how Black Panther was.
Yeah.
Black Panther success came from black people who's never seen a Marvel movie.
Mm-hmm.
But went to go see Black Panther because it was a majority black cast.
Mm-hmm.
Multiple times. Only because it was black people. So,
mm-hmm.
let me get behind this movement. Yeah, I'm probably going to piss off a couple white people. All right. But you black people already buy into my brand. So, we already know you gravitate towards something like this. And like I said, when that news broke, I seen four people telling me, I can't wait to buy 10 pairs of Nikes now. When in your life of buying Nikes have you ever bought 10 pairs at once or had a reason to? So now think about the four people I know in my circle. Think about, you might know 10 mm-hmm. in your circle. You might know 15 in your circle. You get what I'm saying? I might believe that. I'm all for everyone's winning. If there's a win everywhere, if there's their business.
Right.
I get it. But calm down, black people. Like, relax.
No, I'm not saying this is something that we're supposed to just go head over heels for, and just go out and, you know, every piece of, you know, or article of clothing that you have has to have a Nike check on it. That's not what I'm saying. But in this moment, we do have a company that's standing behind somebody that's pushing a movement to try to help bring some type of acknowledgement to what's going on.
I agree.
So, I feel like it's a start. I don't think it's the end all be all. I don't think this is necessarily what's going to fix the issue. Action is what's going to fix the issue. Just kneeling is not going to be enough. We need more black police officers in the urban areas who have come from that area. We need more black politicians. We need more African-Americans who are judges, who are part of the judicial system, who are helping to make these laws. Until things like that start to happen, those are the wins. Those are the ones that we can count on.
I agree. I definitely agree.
And I'm not even big on politics. That's not even my area of expertise. I just kind of know that, like, if you want certain things to happen, you kind of have to have certain people in certain places to kind of help out, to have a voice for, you know, certain people.
Do you think it'll be a bigger impact if, like, instead of players kneeling, if just all black people didn't dress, or anyone who supported it did not dress?
NFL will go bankrupt.
How I feel.
They lose everything.
That's how I feel. Like, you can't kneel in protest and still go play.
Because, yeah, they're still getting what they want. But at the same time, I look at it from both sides. I'm never going to be that person where it's just, oh, I'm just for, you know, what my people are doing because it's supposed to benefit. Like, no, because there's time and time again, we see that there's things that we have done inappropriately. So, if you're going to kneel, okay, fine. That's bringing up some type of awareness. But at the same time, I now want to see you when the game is over out working in the communities. I want to see you at the schools. I want to see you, you know, at the rallies. I want to see you at all the events. Like, don't just show me.
What were you doing in the off season?
Exactly.
What were you doing in the off season?
Exactly. Besides working out and lifting weights and all that, running and all that stuff, that's great because you got to do what you got to do for your body. But when you had your off time, did you spend that in the club? Did you spend that, you know, working on your mixtape or something like that? Or did you go back into the community and try to do something? And I'm not saying a guest appearance where they handed you some money. I'm talking about you went there and you did it out the kindness of your heart because you were actually concerned about what was going on within the community, what was going on around you.
Did you add to the movement or were you?
Yeah, did you add value?
And I get it. Like, I get it because it's almost like the video that was going around of when all the Mexicans walked out of the warehouse.
Okay.
And then the black dude was recording and he was like geeked. Like,
mm-hmm.
Yeah, this is dead. Like, it was like it's just like we have that mentality where
the funny thing was, but he still stayed.
Correct.
You were so impressed by it. Why don't you walk out with him?
Correct.
Why aren't you recording this as you're walking out with them, but yet you're recording it while they're leaving?
And now, what you did see the footage of it was empty, so I'm pretty sure it got shut down. Yeah, so I get why he mm-hmm. probably did not leave during it. Like, he wanted to show, like, this is not no viral
mm-hmm.
thing that somebody put together and say, hey, everybody pretend to walk out. Like, he literally was in that bitch and it was empty. Like, it was ghost town. Mm-hmm. And then amongst our people, our whole thing is, well, I got bills to pay.
Well, that's what I was going to say. I think, like, with the community, like, mm-hmm. think of it this way. And it's kind of like it's done like this. It's purposely, we're conditioned. We have these same routines that we go through, and then the thought process. So within our communities, and I will say in like a Hispanic community, it's very, I'm going to help you get over here. I'm going to help you work. Right. So even as them leaving collaboratively like that is because they knew they had each other's back.
Right.
Which, to be fair, if a whole group of black people left, it's like you have the next man looking at, well, that's dumb. Like, you dumb mm-hmm. for doing that. You got bills, so now you want to live up to the stereotype. You already start calling out yourself more than basically your oppressors. Mm-hmm. So at that point, you know, it's kind of hard. Like, again, like, all right, say you are somebody that's in the NFL as an athlete. Yes, primarily it's all black athletes within mm-hmm. the NBA and the NFL. So if these people were to then just leave altogether as a unit, they've worked so hard physically for their successes that for them to, again, as the brand or as the quote says, that you're sacrificing everything, mm-hmm. that is a lot to weigh, because you never want to sacrifice anything. Right? Or like, too much is still in your head going through. Like, if you had to, like, there's a post that if you have to, there's two people that view getting out of a situation, out of a hole. Mm-hmm. And one is the girl that gets completely naked and she wraps her clothes mm-hmm. onto like a hook of a branch to pull herself out. Right. The other one is looking at, oh, woe is me. How do I get out of it? Mm-hmm. It's because you have to sacrifice.
Wasn't she burning her clothes for the fire or some shit like that?
I don't think so.
I think that was a different one.
That was the one with the wood. The wood, the ladder.
Yeah.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. This one is just for, like, in a situation. Mm-hmm. Right now, the situation is that we can't get ourselves out of being profiled, and pretty much, you know, within these jobs or whatever place we get in society, it's always, well, you could be doing better or mm-hmm. not enough or blah, blah, blah.
Well, I think that's part of the reason why I do what I do. That's why I go to the schools. I go to the source. Mm-hmm. So in some cases, I can tell a grown man or woman that they have the potential to change all these different things within their life. They have the mental capacity to do it and the physical capacity to do it. But if they're so stuck in their ways and they just, you know, they're actually just happy with the drama. They actually kind of like it, you know. They like drama. They like the, you know, the he say, she say. They
forgot the word for that, but I get what you're saying.
You know what I'm saying? Like, they actually like being a part of it. They like being in the middle of it. I can't really do. Something along those lines. It's self-sabotage. But it's like, you can't do anything.
Chaotic.
Right, you can't do anything for that person. You have to, until they hit rock bottom and they get to the point where they're like, yo, enough is enough, I gotta change some things in my life. You can't do nothing for that person.
You can't force a person to change. They have to change themselves.
The best way to actually help a person in that situation is for you to distance yourself from them, and then you go out and you gain all the success that you're supposed to have, so that they can see what it looks like. Because you have to be the physical example for them. There's some people who were a part of my circle and around me, and I distanced myself from them, and they see me now and they're like, yo, Brad, you changed so much. You're really inspiring people. You doing your thing and this and that. And I'm like, okay, that's cool, but you looking at me, what are you doing?
Are you still in the same spot?
Or if you were that motivated by what I said, did you get up and go out and ask for that raise? Or did you get up and, you know, do whatever, you know, try to take the next step, whatever it is. I'm not saying that
try
you gotta
to
be a,
yourself.
Yeah, I'm not saying you gotta be a superstar or something like that, but did you, you know, take some time to work on your credit? Like, did you do something that's gonna actually benefit you? Did you put some money to the side for your child or something like that?
Nope.
Like, different stuff like that.
Nope.
I'm just,
nah, not at all. And that is so dope. Because I can say, even myself climbing up out of the hole that I was in, like, that was like an option that I had, that I felt that I had. Like, it was either take myself out or stay in this hole or get the fuck out of the hole. You get what I'm saying? Excuse my language. Mm-hmm. But it's like I said, you can't force a person to change,
right?
And I tell, and I like, I, and even when we talk about relationships and we talk about that, is you can't force a person to change. You can't force a person to act right. You can't force a, and she hates when I say it, but I say that's what a lot of women try to do. Mm. Like they create like this image in their head of what they see you, what they think you can be, or they see the potential in someone, and they just like, well, I see the potential. You're wasting your time, so I'm going to stick by you to help you see that potential. Yeah, it's just you, like you can't make that person see their potential.
Yeah, you can't marry somebody based off potential. You marry somebody based off facts.
Hell yeah. Or you don't get married at all. But that's
or you don't. Yeah, exactly. So, but that's the thing. You have an option. You have a choice. You can choose not to get married. That's fine. You know, that's up to you. But I honestly feel like the way I look at it is that, and I'm not a love guru, relationship guru, nothing like that in the slightest. But I do actually feel that being able to walk through life with somebody who have made a firm decision between you and God and that person, that you're going to walk with each other until the end of time, and no matter what happens within that relationship, that you made a firm, steadfast decision that I'm not leaving. Like, nothing is going to break this bond that we have. So
your word is your bond.
Yeah, exactly. Your word is your bond. Now, obviously, there's some circumstances that happen that are just non-negotiables, like somebody putting their hands on you, they disrespecting you, they're not, you know, living by the vows that they promised to you and before God, then those are some situations where you need to take a step away from that, because it's toxic. Because
that person is not going, they're not bettering themselves, or they can see that they need to better yourself. I know that was like a tangent, but it kind of tied into the whole seeing toxic people and trying to change toxic people. And
well, it's even simpler to people that, like, I have a lot of friends, especially like in my group, that are artists. So okay. I have people that are doing photography. I have people that are doing music. So mm-hmm. a lot of the music, let's put it this way, they're not willing to even take a listen, or if they do, it's like, eh, or whatever. Like, you know, it may not be your cup of tea, mm-hmm. but the moment that they have even, let's just say, a professional video, it doesn't matter if it's leaked on MTV, on this and that, you know, things that look like they have quality. They could have been shot in their backyard, but right. Things that they've taken the time to perfect, now they want to be, you know, all on them, like, you know, oh man, you got the juice now, you know, you be doing, oh, I saw that you was with X, Y, and Z, because your circle now becomes not with them. And right. a lot of that too, is that whole crabs in a bucket thing.
Well, some people, what they'll do is they want to just keep you within arm's length, mm-hmm. so that they can say that they supported you.
Yeah.
When, you know, the entire yeah. time they really weren't supporting you.
Yeah.
There's been plenty of time. Like, I've gotten more support and more help from people I didn't know from a can of paint.
Strangers.
Just somebody just sent me a DM saying, bro, I listened to that message, I listened to that video, and you inspired me. Or I had a woman call me one day and said, listen, could you just please talk to my son? Could you just talk to my son for a couple mm-hmm. minutes? And I said, absolutely.
Nice.
Yeah. And the craziest part about that is, like, if that message had came from somebody that I actually know personally, like, I would have treated it the same exact way. Yo, Brad, can you talk to my kid? Can you talk to this? Can you come speak here? Can you do this? Can you do that? Absolutely. Like, I don't think there's many things that I've ever turned down. It's nice. Just like my wife, she hates when I do it, but I know I spread myself so thin. Like, I'll be exhausted, go through an entire day, and I'm running back and forth, doing this, doing that. I'm speaking here, speaking there, doing this, doing that. And by the time the end of the day comes, I'm burnt out. And then I got to get up at 5 a.m., 4 a.m., whatever, and do it all over again. And that's the thing that people aren't seeing. Like, they see the videos and they hear the speeches and stuff like that, and they're like, wow, you know, people are clapping for you. And
they don't see the work.
They don't see when I'm getting up at 4 in the morning.
They don't see the work. And right. I think that's the problem. That's the problem with a lot of things. That's the problem with a lot of things that was going on. And I'm actually going to incorporate that into my class. Because I'm a part of a mentor program,
and we're gonna talk about that
we launch. And it's about, I'm the music guy of the program, so it's my experiences from inside and outside of the industry. A lot of people don't see what it takes, or what the process of a song, or the process of learning, the process of a hustle. Mm-hmm. Like, no one sees the 5 hours of studio time where we're not smoking or drinking or listening to the finished product, giving game. Nobody sees the beat on loop for an hour and you just sitting there and you got people walking in and out and you trying to write, or you walk out, you go to a quiet room. They don't see that.
Right.
They don't see, like, all right, you booked 4 hours, but they don't see that three of those four was preparation, was mm-hmm. me trying to call a singer, me trying to call said producer, yo, what yeah. BPM is this? Well, I mean, it's programs to find it out, but I've seen it happen where, you know what I mean, yo, can you send this part of the beat? Can you change this? Yo, can you remove that? Mm-hmm. Yo, this is too loud. Can you only send me the whole session? Like, it's preparation for that. No one sees that part. They only see the glitz and the glamour. They see that. They, like you said, they don't see you getting up at 5 a.m, mm-hmm. 4 a.m.
Sending emails. Correct. And, yeah.
They don't knock on doors
and...
Same thing. It's the same thing for, like with voiceovers or doing things of that nature. Like, they don't see the just sitting in the studio, just like, geez, like,
sometimes it's like, I wish you could just see how many no's I've gotten.
Right.
I wish you could see how many no's I've gotten before somebody said, yeah, we're gonna pay you.
Well, it's funny because my friend, I went to Atlanta, he's an actor now. Mm-hmm. So he's telling me, he's like, don't hype me up, don't gas me up. And, like, it's funny because he doesn't keep in contact with the same old friends. He has, like, maybe two of us, three of us top staple from here, because he was mm-hmm. from Trenton too.
Okay.
So, like, he's like, you know, I rep my town, I do whatever, like, you know, I'm about my stuff. But he's like, people don't know that it took me forever. I had to lose weight for this role, mm-hmm. gain weight, do this, and then for them to then change everything or change the person very last minute. So just to think that you got this close to even getting to your quota, your target for you and your personal gain, to then get shut down. He's like, you know, I'm never going to respect somebody that just thinks that, oh, it's just easy, right? You just live this glorious life. He's like, there's been times that I haven't eaten, you know, on purpose so that I can pay X, Y, and Z.
Oh, yeah.
And then better myself. He's like, don't think I don't go to class every week because it's a thing. He's like, right. You got to go. He's like, actors go to classes. Models go to classes. Things go to classes. He's like, so my money that I'm even going to get a little bit of, because, you know, there's a cut. The producer gets a cut. The casting director gets a cut. Your agent gets a cut. And then you get a cut.
Right.
It's a story that they said about, I don't know, like, how true it is, but it sounded true when mm-hmm. they put it together, about Picasso. They said Picasso, one of those artists. I just think Picasso.
Don't be throwing up names you don't
know.
Well,
I have an associate in fine arts, so come on, let's see.
And he, they said he was in a park and he was drawing. Mm. And a lady was like, draw a picture of me. So it took him 10 minutes to draw a picture of it. And he goes, all right, that'll be $10,000. And she was like, well, it only took you 10 minutes. And he was like, you're not paying me for the time that it took me to draw your picture.
Mm-hmm.
You're paying me for the time that it took for me to learn how to draw you in 10 minutes.
Mm-hmm.
So, like, even as me being a DJ.
I highly doubt that was Picasso, because $10,000 is not a form of currency.
I'm not exactly. It might have been something along those lines.
You take a story, right. And you.
But so, I am going to look it up and I'm going to use it in one of my speeches.
No problem, brother. You already know. No, gotcha. But it's like, even like that, as from like DJ aspect of it, where people don't see downloading. They don't see trying to find songs. They don't see the mental part of, like, I'm looking out into your crowd as I'm DJing a party. Like, if I'm doing a wedding, I got the bridal party and everyone's up dancing, but your grandma and your aunt's been here the whole time and they're just sitting there.
Right.
What can I do to bring them on the floor? You mm-hmm. get what I'm saying? Y'all not doing it. Y'all not going to grab them. You get what I'm saying? They don't see that. They don't see the lugging and the equipment. They don't see the... You know what I mean? Buying equipment. What you got to do to buy this equipment? They don't see the studying. Like, all right, what should I get? So, people need to see the grind. And I say that a lot about the rappers. I was like, yo, if someone put together, like, something, like, a, like, No rapper's gonna want to do it. No rapper, no, like, no rapper's gonna want to do it.
Nah,
they're not gonna want to show that dirty, dirty side of it.
But you know what the funny thing is? That's part of the reason why I don't take down any of my old videos, like on Instagram.
Got to see the struggle.
I want you to see my where I started, where I came from. I literally, I posted.
How far you've gone?
Yeah, I posted a video, like my very first video that I did. I was in my bathroom. Like my mentor told me, "Listen, I want you to, you know, do these videos and this, this, and that." And that's another thing. If you want to become a professional at your craft, you need a mentor. Stop trying to do everything on your own. Like, humble yourself enough to understand.
Someone that's been it before.
Yeah, humble yourself enough to understand that you don't know it all. You don't. You have to go. You have to go where success is. Hence why I joined the communities that I'm a part of, Grindation, with my mentor Kendall Ficklin. Shout out to Kendall Ficklin, and ETA Breathe You with Dr. Eric Thomas, because I needed to be around success. Like, there was no blueprint to what ET. I'm doing. Like, there was no blueprint. Oh, shout out to David Shands.
David Shands, Sleepless for Sleepless Seconds.
Nights. So, there was no blueprint for it. So, you had to go out and find the people who were successful in that area. And it was like, okay, they bumped their head on the wall a number of different times. So, if I can go to you and you can tell me how to keep from running into these roadblocks, my path to success should be so much smoother if I'm just consistent and I'm diligent and I'm, you know, I focus on everything that you're telling me to do and I actually implement the information.
And it was beautiful. Those people that you named, they give you.
Oh, yeah.
They give you the blueprint.
They give you people so much information. People understand that the blueprint
is given, and that's to anything.
Right.
And if you want to succeed in life, like, the blueprints are out there. It's just people don't want to do the work. Like she said, they don't want to sacrifice
right
what they have to do the work.
Well, because it's yeah. backtracking too. So, like, I'm just trying to use, like, obviously modern pop culture for, you know, mm-hmm. for references. But, like, I don't know if you guys watch Insecure at all.
I don't watch TV.
Okay. That's, I was going to say, does your wife have you watching that show?
Yeah,
okay.
She does try to make me watch it. She had me watching the Bobby Brown movie last night.
Yeah, that's
the second part, right?
The second one's on tonight. Yeah, that's all right. Oh, yeah, it probably went off already.
It's being recorded. I'll catch it on the DVR.
Not for, like, you know, obviously, and then I'm going to say spoiler alert. I don't know. But basically, like, what happened in the show was that, damn, I just lost my train of thought just thinking about the Bobby Brown stuff.
Are you talking about how she was
staying with someone on the couch? Or?
No. Okay, now I got it. So, one of the other actresses on there, she moved firms. So she was in a firm where it was predominantly white people.
Caucasian, yeah.
Yeah. So where at that point, she was the only, like, you know, dominant, very fierce black woman. So mm-hmm. now she changed to a firm to where she is, you know, submerged. It's all black firm. So she now feels like her power is kind of, like, stripped from, like, now she's not,
she
like,
she doesn't feel unique anymore.
Right. So mm-hmm. since that's been stripped, because now, you know, she has more people that are like her, she doesn't stand out as much. And, you know, she went to a therapist. She's like, so why do you have to shine so damn bright? Why can't you focus on the things that you can help
right.
to do? So it's the other thing. She's like, starting over is, you know, cutting ties with your past or the things that were holding you back, because obviously being unique in your other setting wasn't beneficial.
Mm-hmm.
So now that you're trying to become a part of a bigger picture, focus on it. And after watching this, and, like, I've been reading books too lately, and I haven't done that in a while, and your mind starts to tick and starts to say, I'm like, well, do I do the same thing? Like, you got to question yourself and, like, kind of G-check yourself and just be like, am I really, like, you know, negative all the time? Am I right. the reason why I can't get ahead in life? Like, all the, like, am I blaming?
You're in your own way.
Right. Mm-hmm.
All right, do me a favor. Hold on right quick. I'm going to test something. Something's bothering me. We're going to pause this right quick. Hold on. And we're back.
That was such a short intermission. I hope.
Facts. But not, like you said, like, you find that you're in your own way. But I don't understand. I'm not going to say I don't understand, because I do this shit myself. Like, I know. And I'm going to sound real ignorant saying this. I know what I'm doing wrong or what I'm not doing that's holding me back.
But you're not alone.
but I just don't do it.
Yeah, like, you're not alone. There's a lot of people who know exactly what they're doing wrong. They know if they fix certain things within their life that they'd be able to get to a different level, but they're not disciplined.
It's discipline. Glad it's I'm the not. Same reason why
it's discipline.
Diets don't work for me.
Listen.
No, the diets work for everyone. You just have to be disciplined enough to do it.
Exactly. Well, that's what I'm saying. Mm-hmm. Like the discipline behind a diet.
The food is so good.
That's true.
It's not that food's not good. It's proportions. Because it's never really.
I like all the proportions.
Exactly.
All of them.
Like when a bag says 4 chips is a serving size. Like, that is disrespectful.
I need an entire whole lot of servings. I'm serving myself. I'm treating myself. But I know we not to say we got on tangents and we talked a lot without actually introducing or saying what it is that you do. So we can get into that portion of it. What is it that you do, sir?
I'm a certified motivational speaker, athlete, servant, community servant, and I'm a man of faith.
All right. Are you a man of faith? Now we spoke about this briefly before we recorded. Is there a certain religion that you follow, or is there a?
Tell you the truth.
Not to get personal, but this is not safe for work. So we talk about stuff that you can't say.
No, you're fine. I have no problem with it. I grew up when I was in Jersey City, Christian background, and then when I moved to East Windsor. My grandparents were Seventh-day Adventists, so they believed in keeping the Sabbath holy, which is one of the Ten Commandments. That
wait
just means
a minute.
Yeah. I know. Hold I just on. Learned a new another faith.
Dude, wait a minute. Yeah. There's more.
There's more.
Go back and say that again one more time.
Yeah. So growing up in Jersey City, I was Christian.
All right.
And when I went to East Windsor with my grandparents, they were Seventh-day Adventists, which means they believe in keeping the Sabbath holy, which is a part of the Ten Commandments. All that means is that there's just a few other things that are a part of the Bible that certain Christians don't follow, and the Seventh-day Adventists do, like going to church on a Saturday. Hence why if you look at a calendar, the very first day on the calendar is Sunday. The last day on the calendar is Saturday. It was actually changed a long time ago to fit the work week. So, like, it doesn't make you any, you know.
And you know what's crazy? Like, and I heard, and I asked a Jehovah's Witness, like, what's the difference? And I'm not going to say she said it, but basically what I got from it is, she is basically like where she said that as like the way she broke it down, I took it as there being stricter Christian.
I told you I want a dictionary of these words.
I mean, I'm sure there's much more to it than that. And that's kind of
not to say what you just said.
Oh, no. That's pretty much it. Like,
that's what she did. Like, she was just like, she explained it to me, and then I was like, so you're a more stricter Christian.
Somehow, she goes like pretty much it.
She was like pretty much where we are, and not to go into it like and like that's like because we spoke about this. Like, you can believe in whatever it is.
Yeah.
I mean, and I appreciate that because I'm the same way. Like, it bugs people out when I say your God. And people are like, what do you mean, my God? My God is your God. I'm like, no.
No, well, I say what you believe in.
Yeah.
Whatever it is that you believe in, because I'm not going to step on somebody's toes like that.
Correct.
Like, you were born within your family, and you guys had a certain faith that you guys believed in. Now, if somewhere along the line in your life, if you were exposed to, you know, God or Jesus Christ, whatever the case may be, and you feel that that is the direction that you should be going in, and you so choose to explore that, then okay.
Talk about
it. But I'm not going to, you know, shove a finger down your throat and tell you that you have to, you know, be a part of this. What I can do is I can only give you the testimonies of what happened within my life, but your experiences in your life are going to be completely different from mine.
All right, cool. So you said that you're a certified motivational speaker.
Yeah.
Don't judge me.
Your lips just not working.
They were. Go more into that. Because like I said, we spoke earlier. Mm-hmm. Like we spoke before the show. We said it is a saturated market.
Absolutely.
Just like everything else.
Yeah. Yeah.
But like
everyone's a comedian now too.
Like, oh God, Jesus.
I was born a comedian. Thank you very much. Okay.
Okay.
Your not that funny, but face it's okay. Is a comedian. It is. It is pretty hilarious.
What do you have to do to become like a certified?
So like I was saying earlier, like you need to find a mentor with some type of program that you can actually train through and work through, to get to the point where they feel that you're good enough to be in front of students telling your story, that type of thing. And that they actually put their name behind, where they would feel comfortable putting their name behind you saying that, yes, I trained this person and they're ready to go. They know how to put their story together. They can give you principle and story and tie it all together. And they have something factual to say. They're not just out there with the, you know, verbal vomit, like, just talking all over themselves. Yeah. I mean, and there's a number of people that do it. They go out, they just ramble on. And I had to learn it myself that, you know, Brad, don't go out there and just talk just to talk. Like, you better have something to say. You better have something important to say, because
and know what you're saying
and know what you're talking about. And don't go out there talking about stuff that you don't know nothing about. Like, if you don't understand this or that, and that's a topic that they're asking you to speak on, either, you know, depending on how much money it is, you can research it and then become, you know, proficient in it and then go out and speak on it.
So much information out there.
if it's an area where, you know, you're not an expert in it, you really just don't feel comfortable, leave it alone. Leave it alone. Don't touch it.
Information out there.
Like, don't touch it. Because the only thing you're going to do is you're going to hurt your reputation, and then you're going to mislead people.
Well, it's like some people don't know when to bow out because they think that they...
Bow out?
Bow out.
And that's
like, because that's pretty much what, especially when you're in front of stage, that's the proper way to do it. You bow out, like you gracefully bow out of whatever the topic is.
I would say left turn. I just want to let you know that.
What?
We're about to make a real mean left turn real quick.
Anyway.
No. Like, we are. So by what you're saying. Bow, I'm going to ask you both a question. So it's about what you're saying. Like, just bowing out.
Okay. I kind of feel like I know where this is headed to, but
should Eminem have bowed out?
Okay. Here's my outlook on it.
I'm sorry. You said bow out. You know what you're talking about.
I'll say this. So, well, I'll put it like this. This is the first time that we've actually had an actual rap battle in a while. Who?
All right. Here's my question. Now, is it? Do you mean like hip hop rap battle?
Yeah.
Or just because, I mean, like, you just had Drake versus Pusha T. You had Drake and Joe Buttons. You had Drake and
they put it on an album. That doesn't count.
Like, that does count.
That to me, that
Ether was on the album. Takeover was on the album.
Yes, but that was fire.
I'm just comparing what she said. Now, somebody did say, because I was talking to somebody and they tried to bring in battle rap with diss rapping, and I was like,
"No,
that's
not the same. It's not the same.
You're giving me 24 hours to be in the studio and write a reply.
Right.
A battle rap, I have like literally no seconds or whatever. However, you're rapping,
freestyle. Yeah,
it's basically like."
I'll say I happen to kind of appreciate it because it's like, okay, I get to actually hear some people that are trying to, you know, be lyrical, right, put some thought behind
it. We haven't had a lyrical rap battle.
Yeah, I'm not asking you to go out there and say the most disrespectful thing that you can come up with. You know, don't low blow people. Like, bruh, you still have to work in this industry together. So it's like, there's nothing wrong with, like, I feel like you won the battle.
I was
going to
disagree with you for a little bit until you just said that.
I would say that in order for you to win the battle, in my eyes, in a rap battle, is you have to be the better lyricist. You have to be able to respond quickly.
We don't have that anymore.
There's no more words.
We don't.
It depends on who you're talking about. When I listen to MGK and I listen to Eminem, they both are lyrical.
I wouldn't say MGK is. I didn't like the diss.
I didn't think it was terrible.
He's lyrical, but that battle wasn't lyrical. Now, when you were saying there's someone that has to bow out, when you're being dissed and praised at the same time, I think that is a message to self saying, all right, maybe, like, you can't.
Well, I think he just kind of didn't want to go too far and make him too mad.
No, he's already he mentioned his daughter's name.
Well,
we all know when it comes to Eminem, when you mention Haley's name, all gloves are off.
Yeah, gonna be a problem. So,
so now, like even with the whole Pusha T, even with the whole Pusha T Drake situation, how they're claiming that Drake had the diss of all diss right. to end, drop it. This is my whole thing, and this is the era that I'm from. LL
mm-hmm.
ended Cannabis's career.
Oh yeah, that was yeah.
Pac and Big were trying to end each other's career.
Right.
Hov was trying to take Nas out. Kiss and Siegel trying to kill each other. Mm-hmm. Like, I want to end your career. And that's my whole thing. If we're, like I get this from my old manager, is this, if we're going to fight, I'm not fighting just to fight you.
Mm-hmm. I'm fighting to win.
I want to fight to, not even to win, I want to fight to harm you. Huh. Like, I want you, like, his theory was, I want you to look at what I harmed and remember. You get what I'm saying? So if we get into a scuffle, I want to break something. I want to break your jaw. So like purposely.
Mm-hmm.
So for that time being that you're wired up, you're remembering, people have to know like how you get your jaw broke. Oh, the Big J knocked him the fuck out. So if we're rapping, I want it to be as if you're no longer rapping anymore. I want to 50 Ja Rule you. I want to end your career.
Yeah. So
obviously, MGK
long story short, you just want to make it known that you don't belong in the same category as me.
Correct. So that's,
yeah, I get it.
So
get
now it. if you're dissing me and praising me at the same time,
but
I just think that I kind of got to sit back and just be like.
But my thing is, we already knew that those two weren't in the same category before it even started. So. Are we surprised? No, I'm not surprised. I'm just taking it for what it was. For this short period of time, there's actually some decent rap to listen to.
So now...
That's it.
I don't know if you listen to Joe Budden's podcast.
No, because...
I don't know if you're not a fan of Joe Budden.
No, it's not that I'm not a fan. It's just that I don't have the time to really, you know... So what I'll probably do is I'll probably catch like clips of stuff like that. And I know he talked about M and he said he was better than him for like a decade or whatever.
He got into it, and
the thing is, even with that, it's just perspective. It's perspective.
It's like, definitely
because there's gonna be other people that are part of his camp that are gonna say he was better than him or is better than him or always has been better than him, and that's fine. Whatever. Like, I'm from Jersey City. He from Jersey City. You know what I mean? My sister went to school with him, so I'm like, cool. You from Jersey City? I'm with it. Like,
it's only a couple rappers who I honestly think that I would like to see battle Eminem. That I know it can go to distance.
The thing with Joe Budden, he's gonna get real lyrical. Like, he's gonna put content to it. Like, he's always been pretty.
He already did it, and this is what pisses me off. It's just like now people are catching on. So people are, oh, Joe Budden this, Joe Budden whack, da 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 da. But now that they're paying attention, because now he has a show,
mm-hmm.
he had Complex, he had Everyday Struggle, he mm-hmm. had the podcast, now he has Revolt, and now the podcast has got a bag and they're gonna be on Spotify. So right. he has new viewers on. So people are just like, nee, I wanna see Joe battle him. Like, I wanna see, like, well, if you were a fan, he already came at him
mm.
and he reaffirmed it today. Slaughter Mouse was at M. That's who he was talking about the whole entire time.
Mm.
So when you listen to it, but my just going off of what you guys were saying about bowing out, when do you know it's time to bow? Because Eminem has never been a content rapper.
Well,
we were all shocked at most of the shit he said, which drew you in to the other stuff. Like, you had Stan, which was a dope song, but then it was also you also have The Real Slim Shady, My Name Is, Guilty Conscience. Yeah. Like, it's lyrical, but it's still shock value. It's just like, hi kids, do you like violence?
Okay.
Want to see me stick 9-inch nails to eat one of my eyelids? Like, that's a shout out to Ben. Uh-huh. Want to try saying, get, you know what I mean?
Yeah. So, my thing
I
is,
my mom, fuck my dad in the ass.
That's crazy.
I got beat up. I mean, like.
So, my thing is with that, you say, like, when do you know when to stop?
Yeah.
When you don't have anything left. When you've given everything that you have to it. So, that's, I mean, you could take that as the rap thing. You can take it as your career. You can take it as a father, wife, whatever. Like, in everything that you do. Like, until you, when you've given it everything that you have, when you empty the tank and you've run it on fumes.
Need the best thing that I got.
And then you like, baby. Okay, I gave it everything that I had. That's I'm done. Song.
I just feel like
Ja Rule gave it everything he had. That was it. He ain't had nothing left.
Nah, he came over to me.
Listen, he tried. Listen, he gave it. He said, clap back. He did what he could. Yo, when
New York.
Like, I'm not discrediting him because he did what he was supposed to do. You don't sit there and just let somebody punch you in the face.
True.
You fight back. And you give it everything you got. It's not like the man is hurting right now in life. The dude, he's still being seen. J-Lo just brought him out on stage. So what does that say? He's still relevant.
Yeah.
He's still relevant in the sense. Even though it may be a negative way, some people might look at it that way. But you can't say that you wasn't, back in the day, bobbing your head.
Keep the same energy.
He was the first one that came out singing and rapping and whatever. And then 50 took his style.
I'm all for it. Like,
I just think that if you're going to go off of what I was saying with bowing out, it has to do with that. But it's not necessarily like if you're saying a rap battle, that's a little bit different. Like when you bow out is really when you're over it. When, like, honestly, it's like having an argument. When do you know to end an argument? When it's no longer, the argument has already surpassed what the fuck you were, whatever you were talking about to begin with.
True.
So that's my thing. That's why with the whole Drake and Pusha T thing, if you think about it, that was just low blows. That was just hitting below the belt just to see
that
how
far. That wasn't a low blow.
I mean, the rap game is different because they feel like you mentioned
my wife's name. All right, you got a son that you're trying to hide. You get what I'm saying? That's the point of a battle, and that's what I was telling people. People were saying MGK came out and he said some dope stuff. No, he didn't. He said get a clipper because they don't like his beard. I'm tired of you wearing those hats and the sweatsuits. You're an angry rapper. You're rich and you have security. You don't come out of the house. You sit in the house and read dictionary. We know this about Eminem. Like, we know. Duh. Like, shit was ass.
That's if you're going to say, yeah.
I think it was terrible, though.
Now, yeah. Pusha T, no one knew. No one knew Drake had a son.
I didn't listen to any of it.
Yeah, he had to talk about it after.
And he had to talk about it. You are hiding a child. Like, he wanted you to hear him say, you are hiding a child. It came after the breath, after a bar. You were hiding a child. And I mean, and then it kind of, you know what I mean? I don't know if his middle name is really My Bed. But they're saying that I only love my bed and my mom, I'm sorry.
I bet you he changed it real quick.
But now people are thinking like, wait, did he say my bed? My bed. Like, I love my bed.
I'm pretty sure in the music video he does like this.
But that's also like my bed. My bed is, you know what I mean, my baby, like baby pictures, they're like this. You get what I'm saying?
Now anything is possible.
I still think Drake should have dropped that disc. But we're not talking about that. My whole thing is when you said when is it a time to like in the argument? If Eminem never dropped that last album and MGK dropped that disc, it would have kind of been like, leave that man alone. That man is, leave him alone. Even with Joe Budden. Like, even if Joe Budden would have came out talking how he was talking today on the podcast, I would have been like, leave him alone. Like, he's chilling. He's asleep. That's like one of these NBA young ballers coming at Michael Jordan. Like, I'm better than Jordan. Da, 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 da. Like, leave that man alone. Like, he's not coming at you. But M came out and came at everybody. So now your old ass is jumping into a young game now. You get what I'm saying? Like, that, those tactics no longer work. What you're doing or what you're going to rap, like, it no longer works, unfortunately, because the audience has gotten dumber. A lot of people missed a whole shitload of stuff that was said on that Eminem album. And LeBron James said it. He was like, you're just either too stupid to understand what he said, or it went completely over your head. Eminem raps fast. He plays on words. Eminem is a very intelligent rapper. I like this last album over the one he dropped before. It's still into me, but it made me want to go back and listen to his older music because his wordplay and this, that, and the third. So that's why I got to the whole bowing out.
But you want him to bow out based off of...
No, I don't want him to bow out.
No.
But I was asking, should he have before he came out with what he came out with?
So
I don't want him to. You can't. You can't be an older person. You can't. Michael Jordan can't come on the news and be like, put me in a game, I bet you I could take LeBron James out. Because now when he busts your old ass, I don't want to hear anything. I don't want to hear shit. Because you came at me. It's almost like, you get what I'm saying? So now when he do what he does to you, now you're tarnishing your legacy. Eminem to me is tarnishing his legacy. Because that, the MJK, MJG, wow. MGK.
Marshall gonna kill me. That's what they said his name is. MGK.
MGK, no. Buttons gonna give him that work. He will give him that work.
But I think
it tarnishes your legacy.
It can and it can't. I mean, at the same time, how else are you gonna stay relevant? I mean, 50 does it for fun. He eats that shit for breakfast. But every 50 day.
Isn't rapping though.
He's not. Yeah.
No.
But we all knew where 50. You know where 50 turned that way? When Ross killed him.
That's true.
He killed him. Then he came out with Pimp and Curly. He had to be funny now. So now 50 Cent, his gimmick is, let me be funny. Which, he's a funny, 50's a funny nigga. 50 funny just, as hell.
It's just,
get the strap.
Get but the strap.
Once but again, it, I think it still turns like, the legacy.
Have you ever seen anything about Eminem backing down from anything? Like, it don't matter if he's his own worst enemy. Like, he's still gonna keep on going.
Correct, but...
But like I'm saying, it's not. There's no shock value with that.
Well, I'll put it this way. It's not like he's gonna lose.
You don't think he'll lose?
He's not gonna lose. Because even if MGK puts out something that's better than his, he's gonna come back with something. And then he's gonna put out one, he's gonna come back with something. But he's not gonna
MGK
stop.
MGK is not a competitor, though.
It doesn't matter.
He's not... He's... Like, you have no... You had, I don't think MGK has more than 2-3 discs in his fucking, excuse me, in his arsenal. All
right, well, let me put it like this. When Kendrick Lamar was on Control, and he brought up, and he, I thought I wasn't going to go there. So when Kendrick Lamar was on Control,
I listened to that 4 o'clock in the morning.
And he named all those rappers on there, including Big Sean.
I was here for that.
Including Big Sean, including Jay Electronica, who were on the track with him. Not one of them said a word to him.
I'm here for that.
Not one of them said a word to him. He literally went down the line. Boom, 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 boom. Everybody that you think is hot right now, I'm getting them up out of there. And none of them said a word.
Jermaine Cole.
So.
Big Crit Wale. Pusha T. Meek Mill. ASAP Rocky. Drake. Like he. Drake. But, Jay Electronica. The what? Mike
but,
Miller.
Listen, but the thing about it is, there's certain people who you just know, bro, don't come for me.
I'm here for that. I am here for that. And I put it up there. I said, it's not a diss or it's not beef if you don't mention my name.
So
he mentioned names.
So my thing is, the reason why the whole beef with, and I'm sorry, I'm spoiled. I was through that era with Nas and Jay-Z. I was spoiled when you get to hear that type of, like, those two legends.
Spoiled,
two like, legends
that
go back
era
and forth.
Of
so
beef?
My thing was, the reason why we still talk about Jay-Z and Nas and that battle that they had and the Tupac and Biggie going back and forth is because in those two situations, just those two, they worked on their craft.
And a lot happened.
They were hard workers, so they weren't coming out the booth until they had something.
Now you got 24 hours to respond.
It's like they'll put their album on hold to make sure that they get this diss track out. Because you're not about to talk about me like that and without everything that I've built because I realize that there's something on the line here. If I just let you talk to me any type of way and decide that you're just going to try to tarnish my career, I will lose my career. And I worked too hard for this. And I'm sorry, that's the same approach that I have to my business. When I go out and I'm working and I'm doing my thing, you're not about to just talk to me any type of way or make me feel like I'm irrelevant or I don't got the juice, I ain't got the talent, I ain't got to do whatever. No, I work too hard to get to where I'm at. So when I send you this invoice, when I send you this contract, when I send you this proposal, put some respect on my dreams.
Oh,
that kind of hurt me a little.
Talk to
it sizzled.
Talk to
Brandon.
It's definitely real talk because it's like a lot of people don't respect it because when we was here before before you came,
mm-hmm.
we were talking about how it's almost like church.
Mm.
where a friend dragged you to church and you're like, I don't want to go. And you're just like, all right, I'll be out in 2 hours. I'm not going to get anything from this, blah, 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 blah. But as the pastor is going on, you're drawn to it. So motivational speaking is almost like that. You go to a school and you say, well, I'm a motivational speaker. Even schools, establishments, they look at you like, all
right, let's see what this one's going to do.
Until you say something and it's just like you said, that was amazing. It's almost like now we want to pay you.
Yeah, I'm walking around like, what are you doing? Oh, I'm just pouring gasoline because I'm about to set this place on fire. And they're like, oh, like, they didn't read, like,
cause it's the confidence in yourself. So,
I'm going to set this place on fire.
We share the same thing. We talk about it as being DJs. I'm about to put this on tilt. Mm. Like, we about to burn the building down. Like, it's the same thing. Like, I listen to E.T. Mm-hmm. I listen to Dave Shands. Mm-hmm. I'm going to look you up also, just from conversing with you. It's the authenticity of...
Here we go.
Sorry, I just threw that in there because, like, I'm just...
You thought I was going to mess it up.
No. I was waiting for a made-up word because I'm making, like, notes of his language.
It's the authenticity of a person who say... Like, a lot of people who say, I'm a motivational speaker. I'm a rapper. I'm a DJ. I'm a producer. I do voiceovers. Mm-hmm. But they only could do 3 voices. It's just like... What happens when you get tired of that? You get what I'm saying? So, or when you said, people are actors. So they get out there and they act and they start to talk and then they'll grab points from here, grab points from here, grab points from back there. And like, yeah, I made a point. Like, no, you just started 4 points and never finished any of them. Would you like to wrap up so you can get out of here? So it's, you're very authentic. Even in conversation, and even when, even in conversing, even with this anything we talked about, our array of topics. Damn, I'm using these. What?
Look at that.
You're on the night.
Look at that. What you give him?
He browsed through that dictionary.
Right, you must have gave him some dictionary pills.
Nah,
you gave him some of the act right now.
I'm intelligent sometimes.
I had to jumpstart the brain before we got to warm it up.
But we talked about our topics and everything. Just hearing how you spoke, hearing how you present to anything that we spoke about, it was just authentic, like. Give us a moment. It's about to sound like an interview.
I was about to get in that too. Go ahead, you first.
Like, give us a moment when you've seen that you changed a naysayer. Like, it seemed you've taken a person from to like pay attention. Like,
probably the very first person, the person who had like one of the biggest impacts was my mother. I told my mother I was going to get a mentor and I was going to quit working in insurance. I had all my insurance licenses. I was a full insurance agent. I let all my licenses lapse because I knew that if I wanted to move forward, I had to let go of everything I had in the past.
No plan B.
So when I told my mom, I said, Mom, I'm going to start paying for, you know, to get a mentor and I'm going to be, you know, immersed in this community and I'm going to work on my craft. I believe this is really what I want to do. I believe this is my gift. And she said, you know, are you really sure this is what you want to do? Like, you know, because she's my mom. She's concerned about me. It's not that she doesn't think that I can do it. She just didn't want me to go down the wrong path and then, you know, feel discouraged about it later. Like, oh, man, like another thing that, you know, I tried and it didn't work out. But something was different this time. Like, I was like, Mom, I'm doing this no matter what. Like, I don't care what it takes. My last dime is going to go into it because I'm going to make this work. And I just started working and grinding and just day by day working on my craft. And it got to the point where my mom called me and was like, I saw your video and that people were talking about it. And I saw they were liking it and stuff like that. Oh, and I liked the message. And you talked about this and you talked about that. Wow. Like you're telling our story. And now it's to the point where she's like, wow, Brad, like you're telling our story isn't just for us anymore. Now it's for the entire world. You're putting it out there. And now they can learn from the story and they can use it and they can take all the lessons and principles from it and they can apply it in their life. And now it's like, yo, you don't have to go through what we went through. Like, you don't have to deal with, you know, the poverty and the drug addictions, and you don't have to be, you know, a high ranking gang member like my father. Like, you don't have to do it. Like, you don't have to go through the special ed classes like I did when I came to the suburban areas and feel like you were lesser than. Like that's something I dealt with my entire life. I never felt that I amounted to everyone else because I was in special ed classes. So I was always trying to, you know, do the best I could in every single thing I touched. Everything I touched, I tried to turn it to gold. Everything. And because of that, you know, I was a jack of all trades and the master of none.
You see, so I thought, see, that's the authenticity.
Come on now, you was on it. Come on.
Nah, that's just the authenticness that I was talking about. Like even your the passion came out as soon as you first started speaking. So what were you going to ask, Bri?
Oh, I was listening. I was just being an active listener. Oh, sorry.
Active listening is important.
I guess, and being a person that also has a craft. So aside from the podcast, I've worked customer service and everything. And it wasn't until, I want to say already like 6 years ago, is when I took like initiative to do like voiceover stuff. And I knew that with the characters, with acting and stuff like that, like I've done boot camps and things like that, obviously to better myself. It's been hard and, you know, this and that. And again, it's the discipline. Mm-hmm. So there's streaks where I'm good and I've actually finally found an outlet where it can become more of a part-time job than per diem, I guess, to say, you know what I mean? When I have time available. Right. So when, I guess, did you, like, you know, kind of it came across to you, like, did you see something that you were like, I want to do this? Like, you know, you said you knew you said this was your calling, but what did you see? What did you gather from? Was it instantaneous? Was it a process in finding, like, you know, your true calling? Like, what, like, if somebody else that's, you know, probably watching now or listening now, that's like, you know, people listen to me, is that one of the key things? Like, what was it that sparked or piqued your interest enough?
It was two things. It was two particular things, and these happened in two different parts of my life. So the first one was, I believe I was a freshman in high school, and a gentleman by the name of Randall Pinkett, he came to High Sound High, and he spoke. And that was the first time. He's the gentleman who won The Apprentice. Yeah, I think it was season 4 that he won. Mm-hmm. And he spoke, and that was the very first time in my life that I saw a successful black man in business who wasn't a football player, basketball player, you know, some type of entertainer, rapper, singer, like none of that. He was a businessman. Mm-hmm. And that was the first time I saw that, and I was like, wow, maybe I could possibly, you know, be a businessman. Maybe I could do something, you know, aside from sports or whatever. You know, maybe there's another avenue for me. Mm-hmm. So that sparked that in my mind. The next time that I really started leaning toward me being a speaker was, as I told you, like, we dealt with, like, some drug use within the family. And my mother and my father, they had a drug addiction problem. Mm-hmm. So my mom used to go to AA meetings. How do I know? I used to be at the AA meetings with my mother. And she was one of the people who did so well within the programs as far as how far she was able to come along and better her life and take care of the family, that type of thing, is that they started having her record herself at the meetings. So they would have her come up and she would speak to empower the other people to help keep them from going back down that path. And she kept the recording, and I didn't get to hear it until I was about 22, something like that.
And how long between those recordings, I guess?
I'm not exactly sure, but I know that was just the first time that I heard it. And okay. she brought it to me. She brought it to my attention. She said, you know, this is a recording that I have. I'd like you to listen to it. And I said, okay. So she played it. And I remember, you know, like yesterday, we were standing in the living room and she was just playing it from like a DVD player. And I'm just listening to my mom speak. And she had so much passion and so much power and so much confidence in her voice that when I heard her, I said, I know that's got to be inside me. like your blood runs through my veins and I'm your son. I gotta have it too. I was like, and I've been thinking about speaking. Like, it's been something that's been on my mind, something that I couldn't escape. I started running into Les Brown videos and Eric Thomas videos and Tony Robbins and, you know, all the greats.
Yeah, if they don't motivate you, I don't know what will.
Oh, yeah, if you don't feel like running through a brick wall after you listen to them, I don't know what you want to do with your life.
A whole brick wall.
Right,
a
whole brick wall. So that was what started. Like, my mom didn't even know that she was the one that really solidified it. And, like, I was looking for a sign. Like, yo, God, just give me a sign. Like, come on, what do you want me to do? And that was it. And I said, that's it. Right. I was like, that's it. If she got it inside her, I'm her child. I gotta have it inside me. Like,
that ability to grab a room. Mm. Is
the ability to audience,
is that ability to be able to some people just have that personality that, like, even if they're the shyest person, mm-hmm. when they say something, when they do something, it's almost like a so it's like, say you had it in you. Like, it's, I was told that when I talk, if I'm like seriously like speaking, talking, my ex told me that. She was like, yo, you just got an ability to make people listen. Mm. And I don't know, because I'd be sometimes animated in what I say, or if I just like let my emotions speak through. Not saying I could become a public speaker or a motivational speaker or a life coach or anything. But like you said, you're telling your truth. You're telling your story. You're telling your thing. Like, even when you said, like, even being in those special ed classes or the remedial right. classes, once again, those are one of the things that'll be a part of my teachings mm-hmm. when we do, when we launch the Reclaim Our Boys thing, because it's just like, even with my daughters now, I kind of look at school as not it's not important, but it's kind of pointless now, because it's, you're being taught certain information and certain information is being removed from the criteria. That's just like, I don't even think they do home economics anymore.
Well, you know, yeah, there's
some, I don't think they do sewing anymore.
Yeah, there's a lot of things that they don't really have anymore. But my thing is awareness is key. Ooh. Awareness is key. So if you know what you're up against, that's half the battle. So right. if I know, and I personally don't have any children at this point in my life, but if I'm looking at the curriculum, if I'm looking at what's going on within the schools, right, and I see that there's this gap. This is missing here, and my child's not going to get everything that they need from you. So that means it's my job as a parent.
Talk about it.
It's now my job to prepare my child for the future, to get them ready. And there's going to be a lot of obstacles and adversity that are presented, because children are so impressionable these days.
Insert a bomb right there.
Like, they're so impressionable these days. So that's the thing. If you know what you're fighting against, then that's half the battle.
And that's one of the because we're about to wrap up. Mm-hmm. That's one of the things that we're doing with the program is mm-hmm. where parents have to be there. Mm. A figure. Oh, a figure now has to be there. Like, see, I remember now, big brother, big sister program, where your big brother, big sister came and got you, or mm-hmm. you dropped them off. Now we need you side by side. So your child, mm-hmm. your mom, we're talking, but I'm like this now.
Right.
I'm coming like this. I'm not just...
Right, right.
And mom just sitting there.
Right. See, my thing is...
We're
here.
We need... Because a lot of people... Parents are... Everything that involves any and everything that's right. going on, parents are removed
right.
from being a part of the problem.
So my thing is, I would, if I could have it my way, I would want the parents or guardians at every single event that I'm speaking at, because 9 times out of 10, the message that I'm delivering for these children are not just for those children. It's also for the adults as well.
Correct.
Because they could also implement that into their lives. Because sometimes we got situations where babies are raising babies. So you might not have had your father in your life. You might not have had this or that. You didn't get the same opportunities, or whatever the case may be. So if that's the case, there's certain things that you didn't learn.
Correct.
But I mean, even in the same token, I don't think it's like necessarily the way that the babies, like, you know what I mean, mm-hmm. raising children, raising other children isn't really the thing. It's how do I explain it? Because like, even for when I got pregnant, people were like, you know, even in my family were like, oh my god, like, you know, now in this day and age, because I got pregnant at 21,
mm-hmm. Brianna's got a baby,
whatever. But my mom got pregnant at 22. Mm-hmm. So it's not too far off. We're only...
Oh, no, no, no. See, but 21, 22, I'm talking about 19. 16.
There's also 16-year-olds and 16, stuff like that, too.
15, but that's what we're dealing with right now.
And the reason being, it's a mix of everything. Think about it, too, because these parents now, like, this even for me, like, I'm trying to implement a career or, you know, go forward where I have a home work life balance, mm-hmm. because, you know, even with that grind, things that we didn't see in the beginning, you know.
Mm-hmm. Home work life harmony. Shout out to Amazon CEO.
Okay. But balance for balance. Me. I don't
know. You need a harmony. You need to harmonize.
Harmony is just is a difficult task in a
ebony and ivory. But go ahead.
Whatever. This is no. See, this is what I can't even get my point across. You see? That's the kind of host I got. But where I'm able to still even be a figure around my son. Just, you know what I mean? Because mm-hmm. that's hard. Because now I'm also in a house where my grandma and grandpa basically helped to raise me. Mm-hmm. And then my mom and dad are helping me raise my son. Mm-hmm. Which leaves me little room because I have to be a breadwinner on top of that. Mm-hmm. So I'm trying to break those traditions. So it's the same mm-hmm. thing. Like, so if that parent is there.
Bread.
You now, know what I mean? Because like mm-hmm. in schools too. Like,
it's that option and choice that you have though.
What do you mean?
Like, are you saying that it's tougher to break the cycle because you're in a house with mama and papa and abuela and abuelito?
No, what I'm saying, which is what I was going to get at, is the same way that if you were to have, like, you know, the parents and stuff, like, because I'm not too sure what schools are you saying, but, like, mm-hmm. I'm assuming you would think that, honestly, having people speak as a collaborative unit or even after school programs, before school programs, whatever it is, making it, you know, super mandatory. Like, is that something that you could push for other schools? Because, like you said,
well, me being the speaker, I can't necessarily push for it. I can suggest it, mm-hmm. but because that's a lot of work on behalf of the school, the BOE, because they're already working on trying to, you know, get the funding for me to be the speaker, right. and make sure all that is taken care of. Then on top of that, trying to get the parents and guardians to be there as well. So chances are, if there was going to be something like that, it wouldn't be during school hours. It'd have to be something
right
on the weekend,
after a weekend,
you know, that type of thing. And the funny thing about it is, an event like that, to be able to impact the students and the parents, the guardians and stuff like that, those are the opportunities that you're like, yo, I would do it for free because this is what I signed up for. Like, if you really want to know if somebody is really concerned, they're really about their craft, their gift, what it is that they're supposed to be doing, ask them if they're willing to do it for free.
Right.
And if they're not, if they absolutely decline, then they might not really be completely about it. Now, I'm not saying if you're somebody who's on the level of, you know, a superstar, you know, Jay-Z, Beyonce, like they've earned their keep. They put in the groundwork. So you got to pay them what they deserve.
Yeah.
You know, you have to. But if you're in, I would say, somewhat the earlier phases, you can't just walk out there and just saying, I'm absolutely not going to do it for free. No, sometimes there's issues within the community and they don't have, you know, the opportunity, they don't have the funding mm-hmm. to work with you. So that doesn't mean you shut them down. That means you give what you can give, you know, and then you continue to work within the community, which is why I still work within Trenton and a lot of other urban areas. They don't always have the funding. Now, is there funding available? Absolutely. Absolutely. But in all circumstances, is there funding available? No. And I completely understand that.
That was kind of like the clip I seen of E.T., when he was at one of the schools and they were talking, mm-hmm. and he flat out was like, listen, I'm here for free. Mm-hmm. I get paid $50,000. I get paid money to do what I'm doing right now for you, little ignorant mother. And I'm doing it for free. So take this game. That's what I was saying. Like, it's so much game being given. There's so many gems being dropped. There's so many blueprints being shown, because that's the whole thing. Like, I just became a millionaire. Now I'm just going to now become richer by telling you the little bits of parts of how to become a millionaire. Or instead of me grabbing you, saying, come with me, let me show you how you can become a millionaire. Like, and it's weird. That's weird to me. Like, that's really weird to me. I mean, some people fall, not to say victim to it, some people fall for it, some people, but I've seen firsthand, hand in hand, when it comes to charging, not charging, mm-hmm. while you're charging. I've seen blueprints of why. It's,
yeah, my thing with that is, in the beginning, yeah, you do offer some stuff to people. Like, you give some advice here and there to kind of help them out a bit. You know, just enough where they could actually, if they used it, if they actually implemented it, they would see some results from it.
Correct.
And then from there, if you would like to continue to, you know, work with that person, if that person wants to continue to work with you, then yes, actually, you're going to have to charge, because you have to put in, I need to know you're serious. So correct. You need to invest in yourself. I'm not going to be the only one investing here.
Correct.
Like, I get people who call and like, hey, how did you get started as a speaker and this, this, and that? I'm like, listen, you got 5 minutes.
My man.
You have 5 minutes. Like, I had somebody who called me complaining about something. And because, you know, he was somebody I knew personally, I gave him some time to talk or whatever, and I let him get it out of the system.
Click.
But then I looked at my watch, and I was like, okay, we've been on the phone for about 30 minutes now, and I let you, and because you're somebody I know, I let you vent. I let you get it out your system.
That was free.
So I'm going to give, I'm going to give you an additional 3 minutes to get the rest of it out of your system, and then let's talk about how we're going to fix it.
And then people, who he think he is. He giving me a time limit. He give me.
And I told him, I was like, listen, I'm a grown man. You're a grown man. I'm not about to sit on this phone with you. I'm like, it's already, you know what I mean? It's already, I didn't give you too much time already. The only reason I gave you this amount of time is because I actually know who you are.
Time is money.
Like, and like at this point, it's now, okay, bro, now let's figure out how, let's, come on.
We got to get back time.
At some point, you got to wipe your eyes and start, you know what I mean?
I can't get a refund on time.
At some point, you got to wipe your eyes, dust yourself off, stand up, and you know, get back to it. Like,
got you. All right. Well, tell the people where they can find you at, my man. Tell them.
Okay. So, on Instagram, it's B_RadInspires. On Facebook, the fan page is B Rad Inspires. So, it's B-Rad Inspires. Let's see, on YouTube. Yep, YouTube, it's B-Rad Inspires, and those are the main ones that I use.
Okay. I felt like I just, like, I don't know, I was listening a lot, so that's good.
There's nothing wrong with that.
No, I mean, like, that just means that you captivate a room.
Oh, thank you, I appreciate that.
No, because there's sometimes, like I said, my attention span is like this little. Well, and then I'm like, okay, tell me more.
Nah, I think it's just that, you know, you were exposed to something different from the, what you, you know, the regular.
Yeah.
So whenever
I told you're just authentic. But this is Not Safe Work Podcast. I'm Big Teddy.
And I'm Bree Wild.
We're also on Instagram. We have, what is it? The NSFW Podcast.
Yes.
I'm
glad you spelled that correctly. I love you.
I love you sometimes.
Mm-hmm.
Me love you sometimes.
But yes.
I had to get time, man.
Yeah, okay.
But Brad, we want to thank you for stopping through. Like, we appreciate that. This won't be the last. We can go forever talking about this. Like, just everything. So it's definitely not going to be the last. I'm going to give, I'm keeping your card, but I'm also going to tell Free,
mm-hmm.
To invite you out to the next meeting for the Reclaim Our Boys mentorship program, because you have a message and your message needs to be heard. Bree, do you have any parting words?
Oh my God.
Oh, I can't even give like a voice. I can't even like, you know, entertain
oh my
you.
God.
Yeah, sorry. It doesn't work. It's like your confidence is giving me strength and it doesn't work.
Perfect timing. And we're out of here.